I've picked the right sort of themes to talk to you about today. It's really, in a sense, a set of partially connected observations around the curation of data in a number of different research fields, but particularly trying to think about the relationship of those activities to publishing. To publishing as we've known it, and to publishing as we might be thinking about it in the future. And a few scattered observations. I don't claim to have a complete picture of this by any means. A few scattered observations on why we want to do certain things, how we might be doing them, and where these actions might be taking place. As Anthony has said, I'm the new director, or Hai He Jin, as my staff in Edinburgh prefers to call me, of the Digital Curation Centre in Edinburgh. We're there primarily to provide advice, to encourage activity around the effective management of research data in, well, certainly in UK universities, because just we pay the bulk of our costs are concerned with that, but also in the wider context. Research increasingly is international. You can't just think about it happening in an individual country. So, two parts of the theme then: data and publishing. And one of my concerns, I think, is that often when we discuss these things together, we either see them as having equal primacy, or even as the data somehow supporting the concept of traditional publication. And it's my feeling that increasingly, actually, the roles perhaps are beginning to shift. Not that scholarly publishing is going to go away, and in a year's time all the journals will disappear. As Anthony said, that's, you know, somewhat excessively a futurist attitude. But I think there are already trends we can see that mean perhaps the balance of what scholars will want to do in different disciplines is changing. One of the things the Digital Curation Centre has done is tried to visualise a sort of single life cycle. This is a model we've come up with to attempt to describe the set of operations that people might care about in terms of managing data. I don't intend to explain all of these things, and like all of these models, you know, this is not, it shouldn't be treated as a religious text to be followed slavishly. It's a way of framing thinking. It's a way to enable people from very different backgrounds and very different disciplines to try to understand what commonalities might exist in the process of conducting research, of gathering information that supports it, and of publishing about it. And I think what I'm going to be focusing on today is two parts of that life cycle. One to do with access, use, and reuse of the information that we collect around research, and that's really what publishing supports. And also, earlier on in the cycle, this concept of appraisal and selection. Now, when we put this life cycle together, I think that we are very much thinking about deciding what data is actually important in the long term. But of course, in the publishing context, peer review is essentially it's an appraisal and a selection process. It's part of the decisions of, you know, what is it worth, what's worth publishing. And I think that process, the fact that process is applied to data and it's applied to the publications around it, and at the moment I think that's there's a great disconnect between those two processes, and perhaps we can do more to bring the two together. And the rest of that last cycle, it's all important, but it's not going to be the subject of what I'm talking about today. I'm going to begin by touching on some of those issues around open data, and particularly around the ideas of citing and referencing data as well as the publications and different approaches people are taking to that. Then to say a little about why I think data, in terms of how we cite it, find it and reference it, is different in terms of from the publications we're used to dealing with, and why that might mean some of those approaches have to change, and say a little about some of the approaches and the strengths and weaknesses of them. Now, in one sense, I'd hope that this audience, I shouldn't really be having to try and explain to you why we should even care about some of these issues of being able to cite and reference data separately from the publications around them. But I think it's worth you know, perhaps reminding ourselves of the different reasons why this is important, because the fact there are a lot of different reasons to care also have an impact on the processes that we might want to apply to dealing with the management of data. So here's one simple example, a couple of images from a publication about techniques that are used with instruments to look at clouds and deductions you can draw from that about weather, about meteorology, perhaps as a secondary effect also about issues to do with climate change. So they're pictures. I'm telling you that there are clouds and two different images, one of which uses radar, one of which uses lasers. There's a point behind this in the paper that actually neither one of these instruments tells you the full story, that you need to combine them both together and that you need to use certain mechanisms to pre-process that data to find out what we want to find out. Now, if you dispute what that paper says, it may be that the conclusions being drawn are so grossly different from the story that the picture tells us that the picture alone is enough for you to say that's wrong and this is why it's wrong. But it's far more likely, especially given that these are just two examples from a very, very large collection of material, and I think you need the whole collection to tell the story, that you actually need to get at the information that's behind these images. And actually, you might want to get at the information that's even further away. This information is the data that comes out of the instruments is processed quite heavily to remove all sorts of things that are basically not interesting if you're caring about ice in clouds. But quite recently, there were other things wandering around in the air over Europe that we cared about quite a lot. And a number of people involved in this area of research realized that if they went back to their raw data from these instruments, as opposed to the processed data they usually deal with, that they were very good at spotting where volcanic ash was. Stuff that had previously been treated as noise now became the data. And there's a whole set of other bits of research you can do around that. Another reason why graphs alone may not tell us the whole story. This is a presentation, a discussion that happened in my own university quite recently. Somebody quite senior was telling us this is what the university funding picture is going to look like over the next 10 years. It's going to be a big dip. It's going to take 10 years before we even get back to where we are today. Probably agree with that. That looks pretty scary. But actually, you can use the same data behind it and come up with something that looks like that. The same dip is there, but it's not quite as frightening as it was before. Now, this is a technique as old as pills, and if you've read Dalton Huff's How to Lie to Statistics, you'll be familiar with this. Journalists are fond of it all the time. It's the idea that you can make a graph look more interesting by not using zero at the bottom of the scale, but rather picking 14, in this case, as being the zero point. And what we really ought to be doing for that graph is drawing it like that, and they look very, very similar there. Now, actually, there was a good reason for doing this, and the person who gave the presentation said the reason why I've done that, they were honest about changing the zero point, is that this may be the truth, but that other graph with the big dip, that's what it's going to feel like, because so many of our costs are things that we don't really have any control over. So there was a point to that distortion, but in other cases, people are not so honest about why they present data in different ways. So that's part of the reason why people talk about this generic, the data behind the graph problem, that the data in support of a publication should be as accessible as the publication itself, because otherwise we can't really conduct the sort of scholarly discourse that we want to be able to do. It means that we can challenge findings, we can replicate them, we can come to a greater understanding of things. And already, many publishers are beginning to deal with this directly by storing some of the information behind the publications, although sometimes all they're storing is the graphs themselves in a more accessible form rather than the raw data, or else they're working with others to enable data and publications to be linked more closely. And we're going to be hearing about at least one of those ventures, Dryad, I know, later on tomorrow. I think that's the case. And sometimes people are simply associating those items with the digital object identifier that's assigned to the paper. I'm glad to hear this is one of the acronyms I don't need to explain.
We're
all familiar with DOI. I wasn't sure about this. And sometimes DOIs, these objective identifiers, are being assigned to the data quite separately from the DOIs that are assigned to the publication itself. They're all interesting, they're useful, they're better than nothing, but there are drawbacks with that approach. One of the reasons is that the data that I use to support my publication is not necessarily the data that I originally collected. And sometimes that's very, very important. There's a number of cases we've seen, for instance, with drug companies who've been very, very selective about what data they use to support publications. One of the simple things being, if you're looking at a small effect on something, if you conduct a trial often enough, sooner or later you'll come up with the answer that you want purely by chance. And therefore that's what you publish. And you have lots and lots of other data that tells quite a different story. And nobody needs to know about that. Well, there's another reason to care that's important both to scholars and to publishers. Everybody wants more impact. Everybody wants citation. That means that the journal looks better, it has a higher impact factor, and for the academic they care more. So at least one study, and probably others, has shown that there appears to be a relationship between accessible data and increased citation rates. One particular study a couple of years ago looking at a very specific area to do with microarray cell studies. I'm not going to try and say that word again. But this is a very specific area of science. They looked at a large number of papers, some of which had accessible data and some of which didn't. The 45% of the studies that had accessible data received 85% of the citations. That sounds very, very persuasive. But I must add that note of caution. Correlation is not the same as causation. It may simply be that people who do good research make their data accessible, and good research is obviously cited more often. My heart wants me to believe that making your data open is what increases the citation rate. I don't think we yet know that it's as simple as that. On the other hand, you know, you don't want to take that risk, do you? It's a good idea. At the moment, we seem to have this evidence. What harm is it going to do? And maybe you'll be better off because of it. There are other reasons for wanting to make sure that data and publications are thought of as separate, to some extent, although related and independent things. It's quite possible that you've produced some information that in itself is really interesting to me, but actually what you've got to say about it is utterly irrelevant. And the traditional scholarly model in which the publication is what I criticise or comment on site does not fit well with that. Now, one rather artificial example of that might be, you know, you're a geologist and you've gone and collected information about rock types in Crete, let's say, and it's supporting some theory you've got about tectonic drift or whatever it is that the geologists are up to. So you've published your theory in a scientific journal. I, however, am interested in pottery and the pigments that they use. Now, I've got some theories about where the pottery came from and how the pigments were produced and who was involved. And this information about what sort of rocks were available in a particular area is really useful to me in supporting that theory. I will not be publishing in a journal on geology, and what you have to say about what happened a billion years ago is uninteresting and irrelevant to me. I'm really glad you collected that information. But other than the fact that I ought to cite you and give you credit because you collected it, I'm not going to have a lot to say about what you have to say about these things. There are two quite separate scholarly discourses going on there. And there are other reasons why, I mean, that sort of reuse is one very simple example. There are much broader ones. Biodiversity, for instance, is generally considered to be something that's good. You know, more biodiversity is better than less biodiversity. If we accept that to be true, one of the problems is we understand very little about what promotes it. What causes more species to exist or less species to exist? The theories we have generally, there are lots and lots of bits of evidence that show us that all the theories basically don't hold water at the moment. But trying to really understand the process behind this is not something that any one project or data collection exercise is going to be able to deal with. You're going to have to deal with lots of different data sources. It's highly likely that not all of those will themselves have been published, or that the reasons they were collected or published may be may have had little or nothing to do with biodiversity. Certainly information about the geological sciences is going to be part of it. Some of the data won't even be collected for research. Much of it is likely to be government data or other sorts of public data sources. And we're going to be hearing again, I know, later on about the importance of those official data sources in research, which are often published as data rather than published as data which supports research. And one of the other things we want to be able to do from being able to look at a very, very big picture of data from many sources is to understand what other things do we need to go out and collect? Where do we need to fill gaps in our knowledge to understand that particular research question? And one final thing, if none of that has yet convinced you, some of you may already have seen a presentation from a conference earlier this year from somebody called Josh Summer at the SAGE BioNetworks conference. And if you haven't, I'd urge you to look at it. I've heard descriptions from people there that it was a presentation that moved some people in the audience to tears. That's not something that happens very often at an academic conference. Josh Summer suffers from a very rare disease, which is the sort of thing that because it's rare, there's not a lot of research going on about it. And he himself is now a leader in a research foundation attempting to understand what's behind this. And part of his concern is that there's all sorts of data out there about brain chemistry, about genetics, about lots and lots of things that probably hold part of the answer to what may kill him quite soon. And his concern that so much of that data is either locked away or it's exposed in a way which ties it too closely to the publication and the research question that the original people wanted to answer. And that doesn't help him find the information he wants. Because again, the reason it was collected is not the reason it was useful to him. So there's a compelling reason there that the data itself needs to be exposed in a way that helps you understand what it is rather than what somebody wanted to publish about it. Okay. So I'll say a little about why I think treating data is different. We're used to dealing with things and publishing things that wouldn't look out of place somewhere like this. Even though lots of our scholarly discourse now is electronic, it's very easy to imagine printing it out and putting it on a shelf and giving it a shelf mark and associating with all that resource discovery metadata that we're used to having. Lots and lots of data does not fit well into that model at all. It's useless to you on paper. For one thing, it doesn't fit. It doesn't have a beginning and a title and an introduction and an end and all the sorts of things that we're used to having with traditional stuff. Now, we all know that, but I think sometimes we forget it when we're trying to think of models that are dealing with data. The data is often, it's produced in a really different way from publications. It's collected often by instruments, a wide variety of them, some of them small and exotic, some of them on a larger scale that we're more familiar with. But the other thing about lots of this data is that although some of it, in some disciplines, is like the traditional publication in that we start with something, we collect it, and then it's finished, and then we wrap it up, and it's not going to change, and then we publish about it. So lots of studies in the social sciences fit into that sort of thing. Lots of work in other sciences as well does that. Other collections of data are permanently being added to every minute, every second, every hour, where they're permanently being altered and curated and adjusted and improved. That's a very, very different thing from the traditional publication. And it can happen in many different places. On a global and an international scale, the data can be curated often in national resources. There are subject centres dealing with it, such as this group dealing with social science data in Europe. Increasingly, responsibility is taken by institutions who are extending their work with institutional repositories often to deal with that. but it's often being done by research groups, and sometimes it's being done by individuals. The curation, the publication, everything. Now, publishing is diverse as well. You know, we've got large companies doing it, we've got small university presses and scholarly presses, but I think there's even greater diversity in the set of people that are dealing with the management of data. And it's important, again, to remember in this life cycle that the publication parts of the process are just one step in the life cycle. And if we focus on them, we may make the job harder than if we try and fit in to all the other parts of the management process that will take place at many different levels and with many different actors. It's like a smooth integration with all those things. So I'll say a little now about some of the approaches that people have taken to publication and why I've got concerns about some of them. So this idea of giving data digital object identifiers, DataCite is one international organisation for sure we're going to be hearing about from Adam Farquhar, certainly, if not others. The idea here is, again, it's still focused on that, the publication being the primary thing, the scholarly, the paper, the book. And what you want to do is capture the data that's behind that, give it its own identifiers so you can use existing infrastructure to retrieve it. But often what you're capturing is a subset of the original data. You're freezing what might be a living thing and putting it somewhere else and saying, here is what that stuff looked like at the point of publication. It's a very publication-led approach to dealing with data. I think it's also important to bear in mind, I look back at the description of this event, and I mentioned these three sets of actors, scholars, librarians, and publishers, as having to work together to solve this. And I agree that we all need to work together, but I believe that set of people alone aren't enough to deal with this problem. And even now, there are already other actors involved, those running large subject-based data centres, for instance, who are also a big part of the answer, and it's important that we don't leave them out. And they're part of this reason why data is different. They are not involved in the traditional scholarly publication process. But they remind us that process of curation is something that goes on before publication, it goes on after publication, and in some cases there is no publication of a paper, but there is an important data resource that's actually receiving lots and lots of use. Maybe cited independent there. I mean, here's one example from the States, National Oceanographic Atmospheric Association. I'm asking, I can't remember now what the acronym stands for, so please don't ask me to explain it.
No, but
they've got their World Data Centre. That's an impressive name in itself, isn't it? There's a statement on its homepage. They want you to properly cite the data when it's used. And they've got a whole set of instructions for how you go about doing that. Now, that's good in itself. They're not simply telling people cite our data, they're telling you how to go about it. One of my concerns about this is that I was at an event about reference management citation earlier this week in a more general sense, and there were a few people that were concerned that we're teaching students too much to worry about where to put the dots and the commas and the brackets in citations, and not teaching them enough about why do you do this at all and how do you go about doing it. And this looks to me like another one of those let's get the dots and commas in the right place. You know, a set of four different citation styles, depending whether you're talking about published data or unpublished data, or stuff that's come from a cooperative, or stuff that has too many authors to list. And it's very, very particular. You know, put that bit there, then let's have a comma. Put the year there, put this bit in brackets. Now, that's good, but this is not something I can act on. And increasingly, I want to bring lots and lots of any stuff I do with data from this place is going to involve a lot of computing power and a lot of machine-driven stuff with human intelligence coming in towards the end. It's a huge amount of effort to go from this to getting that data into a system where I can do something sensible with it. It ought to be easier, and there's no reason why it shouldn't be. Many publications are going to use lots of bits of one data set, and it might change alley, as I said, sometimes they're petabyte size. These things do not lend themselves to being replicated and frozen somewhere else And publishers certainly don't want things that big to be dealing with. They want someone else to be managing that stuff. And snapshots in that sense, backing a publication really to my mind, don't solve the problem. And they also run the risk of losing the context of the original. So let's imagine here a set of traditional scholarly publications, articles in a journal, and they're all dealing with publishers who've taken on this idea of data. They're giving digital object identifiers to the bits of data that support each of those publications. What will not be apparent to you at all from those identifiers, and it may even be difficult to work out from the text, could be that all of those things have actually come from one original primary data source, a big, rich primary data source such that nobody uses all of it for a particular publication. And yet many people are taking the approach that all you do here in backing up the publication is to take the little bit of it that you used, a few columns from a table, a couple of tables from a big data set. And yet, surely what we really want, we do want to know that all of those things depend on that original source. And we're in danger of losing sight of that. So it's worth reminding ourselves, I think, of, you know, here's one particular view from the University of California's Curation Center about what their view of digital curation is. Part of it is about you need to facilitate these things, more than data management, by enabling persistent citation and actionable reference, a reference that enables you to do something. And they've also got words around resource discovery and resource description there. We heard earlier from David how important that is. So there are other approaches to dealing with big and changing data. One way is not to make copies of the stuff when you publish about it, but to keep change records and have reference mechanisms that allow us to reconstruct what something looked like at the point where somebody used it, even though the world has since moved on, where that's important. There are similar techniques already being used, for instance, with web archiving. Some of you may have heard of a tool called Memento, which can be integrated with web servers and allow them to present a web page as it looked at a particular point in time. Very, very simple technique that just very, very slightly extends how we use the web and has huge potential, I think, for how web archives work. It requires a bit of cooperation between the person curating the data, perhaps the publisher as well, and the person doing the reference. But there are techniques to make this possible. One of the things we also have to bear in mind is that we often end up thinking of data behind publications as being simplistic things like this, a simple rectangular table of stuff. But they're often far more complex than that. There are often many, many, many tables of data with very complex sets of interrelationships. And one of the problems, for instance, we used to deal with, I used to be involved in government database preservation, was sometimes deciding for very, very large government systems what we were going to take out of them in order to archive them. Very often, the data in a system and the business processes around it, and for business process substitute research activity or whatever, mean that there are lots of different views of the same underlying set of data, and it can be very, very difficult to decide which bits of that data you need to in order to preserve information about a particular set. Thank you. Now, one of my colleagues at Edinburgh, Peter Booneman, computer science there, has wrote a few years ago what I think is a very insightful paper on this issue around curating data and citing it. And although parts of the paper, particularly towards the end, really do get into the depths of serious computer science that I certainly don't claim to understand and I wouldn't recommend to most of you, the first few pages of that paper are accessible, I think, to anyone who's ever thought about scholarly publishing. It's very, very lucid writing. And I'll summarise what he sets out in his paper as what he calls the desiderata of data citation. And I think these are straightforward things to understand. And whenever you look at any mechanism that somebody suggests for managing data and citation and tying it to publications, it's worth seeing whether or not it satisfies these rules. So he uses one little bit of notation, the idea of a citation on the one hand, and the thing it references, the thing that is being cited on the other. That's the thing in brackets. So here's a really simple set of things he wants. Once you cite something, the thing that you cite should be fixed. But it shouldn't go changing underneath you. We're used to that. We don't expect people to go back and change journal articles after we've referenced them. On the other side of that is that if you find something by other means, and if you use Google and you find some interesting and curated bit of data, you haven't followed a citation as such, it ought to tell you how to cite it. His next desiderata is that you should be able to cite a database at multiple levels of coarseness, either that entire thing with lots and lots of different tables in it, or a particular subset of it, because that's the only bit that you're interested in. And given that you can do that, if you have two citations to the same thing, one of which refers to a smaller piece than the other piece, then the location information of the citation ought to make that clear. In other words, it ought to be able to compare two citations and say, these are pointing at the same, either the identical thing, or one of them is pointing at a superset of the other. They're simple ideas, and yet many, many of the schemes that people propose don't satisfy all of those. He has another which is getting into his more computer science, but I'm not going to go into why he says that, that versioning should be done at the database level. Okay, I'll briefly acknowledge some of the sources of some of the images there, stopping only my sheer pleasure, many years ago when I was working with government databases, happening to work with a company called Happy Computers Limited.
Oh, nice.
They're based not very far away from here in Gray's Inn Road, and I sincerely hope they're still going. The mere thought of working with them fills me with joy. And I can't leave without a brief word, as it were, from our sponsors. I'll remind you all the 6th International Digital Curation Conference, which I'm happy to work with Alan Rainier and other colleagues on that, is happening in Chicago later this year, and I'm sure the flights will be working normally. And I'm told it's a beautiful, beautiful place to be in this
country. Take your woolly boots.
So I'll end by trying to, you know, if there are any points that you're going to take home from today, these would be it. Thinking of data solely as an adjunct to publication is too narrow a view. When we're thinking about resource discovery, when we're thinking about reuse, the data and the publication now, I think, are beginning to have, ought to be thought of as having equal prominence. Each of them has a role to play, and each of them, it's a bi-directional linking. We need to be able to find data and say, what have people said about this? What have people published about it? As well as going in the other direction. The data is often a living thing. We need to treat it as such and not attempt to freeze it in ways that are unnatural to it. Remembering that it's not just scholarly research that generates the stuff that scholars are interested in. We're interested in material that comes from outside that domain, and therefore solutions that only deal with the outputs of scholarly research are not sufficient for us. And finally, going back to all those reasons why I said we should care about this at the beginning, hiding data away is wasting it, in the same way that not publishing your research is wasting your research. We all understand that we need to publish and communicate to the rest of the world our findings, and we need to do the same with our data. And at that point, I thank you very much.